I want to talk for a moment about early childhood education, which of course lays the foundation for a child's future success in kindergarten and throughout their primary education. Sadly, we still have too many Ohio children who are not prepared to enter kindergarten. And so we must do more. We must do more to ensure that all Ohio children get to the starting line. That's why we're revising Ohio's child care quality rating system to simplify and reduce paperwork, focus on better child outcomes, and for the first time ever, provide our quality rated programs access to curriculum that's aligned with the science of reading. Further, we're making child care more affordable and making it more accessible to Ohio's working families. Doing so, we will build today's workforce by getting people back to work, and we will ensure that tomorrow's workforce is prepared for the demands that lie ahead. With the help and support of the General Assembly, we have expanded access to child care in Ohio's public preschool programs through greater eligibility and funding investments. As a result, we are now serving 16,000 more children today. And we're going to do even more. I'm very pleased to announce the creation of Ohio's new Child Care Choice Voucher Program for Ohio families that make up to 200% of the federal poverty level, or $60,000 for a family of four. This new program will provide financial support for 8,000 more Ohio children. Not only that, we'll also be allocating federal funding, reallocating that federal funding, to dedicate $85 million to create child care access grants to improve and expand existing child care facilities. And to help the many parents caring for their children with special needs who can't find child care providers, we've created Ohio Promise, where early childhood professionals learn how to care for and teach children with disabilities. And the results have been good. In less than a year, over 2,700 professionals have been trained. And we have seen a 20% increase in the number of children with disabilities who are now being served. By doing all of these things, we're helping more families. Businesses will find more workers, and Ohio's economy will thrive. You know, when I think about how we can shape education for the greatest benefit of our children, I'm reminded of something that our high school principal, Mr. John Malone, once told Fran and me. Mr. Malone said that when it comes to education, only two things really matter: a willing student and a good teacher. A good teacher, we think about this, a good teacher has the power to fundamentally change the course of a child's life. I'm sure that each one of us can recall at least one great teacher who inspired us or motivated us and really changed our lives. I want to take a moment to thank all teachers in Ohio. In the gallery with us today are Ohio's 2024 Teachers of the Year. Will you please stand so we can give you the applause? Ohio's Teachers of the Year. We also know that school building principles are vitally important to a school's success. They determine the culture in the school. A great principal is the leader in the school who creates the conditions for students and teachers and staff alike to thrive. That's why I've directed our new Department of Education and Workforce to create a principal apprenticeship program so that aspiring principals can watch veteran principals in action through hands-on in-school training that will better prepare them for the challenges of the job of a principal. This builds on Ohio's successful teacher apprentice program and will ensure that schools across the state have the leadership that they need to succeed. Let's talk for a moment about education requirements. Ohio law today dictates that every student must have a plan on how they will meet their graduation requirements. Yet, the law fails to require, maybe the most important thing, a plan for students to find a career they love and can excel at after graduation. Every Ohio student needs a graduation plan that includes not only how they meet their course requirements, but also what they intend to do post-graduation and how they intend to pay for it. So today, I'm asking the legislature to make a very simple fix in our statute to insert career planning into existing graduation plan requirements so that every Ohio student leaves school on a career pathway. You know, Fran and I want for all kids what we want for our own children and grandchildren, and now our great-granddaughter, who, by the way, is right up there, Betty Jane. Come, Maddie, you got Betty Jane. All right, our new great-granddaughter. It's for them to find. We want everybody, all our kids and grandkids, great-grandkids, to find something they're deeply passionate about and they can pursue as a career. For many Ohio students, they find their passion and pathway through career tech. Fran and I and Lieutenant Governor Houston have visited career tech programs all across the state, and they're doing absolutely some amazing things. Yet a couple of years ago, we would repeatedly hear that kids were being turned away from career tech because there wasn't enough room in the classes, or there weren't enough slots open in a student's area of interest. And sometimes the school didn't have the right equipment, or it was simply too old. With the strong support of you, of this legislature, we have been making historic investments to eliminate wait lists and ensure that any Ohio student who wants career tech education has access to it. Because of your action, in November, we were able to announce a $200 million in grants to build and grow new career tech classrooms. And just last month, we awarded more than $67 million to programs for new equipment. As our high school students plan for their future, they need to have all kinds of options, certainly including career tech. Members of the General Assembly, you and I commit together that in the future, we will do what we have to do so that no Ohio child who wants career tech is ever shut out of that because there simply is not room for them. If Ohio is to compete in the 21st century, we must have an all-of-the-above attitude regarding education. Just as we need welders, mechanics, those who understand advanced manufacturing, we also need chemists, we need engineers, we need researchers. We need those with career tech credentials, as well as those with two-year, four-year, and advanced degrees. We need to play to our strengths. We have a lot of them. We are blessed with great colleges and universities, and have become a net importer of college students from other states. But we must keep more of our own students here in Ohio. So I want to thank the members of the General Assembly for helping us to enable more Ohio kids to go to college in Ohio, and then to stay in Ohio to fulfill their dreams. Since 2019, we've successfully persuaded all 14 universities in Ohio, public universities, to provide four-year tuition and room and board guarantees so that no Ohio family will experience an increase in college costs once their child starts college. When I came into office, Ohio's need-based aid for college students, the Ohio College Opportunity Grant, or OCOG, had been cut nearly in half from its all-time high in the year 2007. We've now been restoring that aid with your help for Ohio's neediest students and have more than doubled the per-student award. And for students in STEM fields, we've also doubled funding for the Choose Ohio First Scholarship. And finally, the top 5% of Ohio high school seniors who will be graduating in just a few weeks will be the very first students to receive Ohio's new Merit Scholarship, renewable for up to $5,000 for each of 4 years. All of these scholarships will help keep Ohio college students in Ohio. And I look forward to working with you, the General Assembly, to keep even more students here in Ohio. You know, we used to look at how many students started college. Then in 2013, we changed that, and we started holding colleges accountable for the number of those who actually graduate. It's now time to begin measuring how many of those who graduate have a job in 6 months, and if that job is related to their college degree. So today I'm asking the Ohio Department of Higher Education to collaborate with our colleges, our universities, to begin collecting this data. When picking a college, our families deserve this information, and we must make sure that they get it. Now, when a child is not healthy, that child will not thrive in school. So let me talk about children with vision problems. If a child has difficulty seeing, they will certainly have difficulty reading and difficulty learning. Tragically, that is the case for too many Ohio children today. Today, all Ohio children are required to get a vision screening test in school. But other children who fail that screening test, the vast majority of them never get a comprehensive follow-up eye exam to determine if they need eyeglasses. That's wrong. It's wrong that in the third decade of the 21st century, tens of thousands of children in Ohio who need eyeglasses are simply not getting them. However, there's good news. There are leaders across Ohio who are demonstrating and doing great work so that children can get eyeglasses. For example, the wonderful people at Sight for All United in the Mahoning Valley and Athens Eye Care Mobile Clinic in Appalachia are bringing comprehensive follow-up eye exams directly to our schools. They're here with us today in the gallery. I'd like for them to stand up from these two organizations. Thank you for what you do. Their models work, and we must take these models statewide. Today I'm announcing the creation of the Children's Vision Strike Force. This will not be a study committee. We know the problem, and we know the solution. Rather, this group will work with vision care professionals in every corner of Ohio to scale the proven models, to scale these proven models statewide, and to provide schools with the technical assistance they need to implement these very important programs. Ohio, sadly, has never had a statewide plan to ensure that every Ohio child who needs glasses will get glasses. Now we do. Another challenge that we face is that too many Ohio children and adults live in communities Well, they do not have easy access to good basic primary health care. A number of Ohio schools have partnered with hospitals or other providers to bring primary care inside the school building for the benefit of the children and the adults who live in the community. Less than 3 miles from here, for example, Nationwide Children's Hospital is serving the youth at East High School inside their school building. Thanks to a clinic right on the school grounds, students are able to schedule appointments with healthcare professionals or walk right in if they're sick. These clinics work. These clinics work because our schools are the heart and soul of our communities. It's where people are used to gathering and where people are comfortable going. They also have a significant impact not just on students' health, but also on their academic performance, including improved attendance, higher GPAs, grade promotions, better college prep, and reduced rates of suspension. As part of the General Assembly's historic investment in Appalachia, we've enabled local communities to determine their revitalization priorities. We recently announced the new Appalachian Children's Health Initiative, which will be helping 20 Ohio counties to create or expand community and school-based health clinics to serve at least 61,000 students and 375,000 residents in Appalachia. I think it's important to note that these communities decided this was their top priority. Today, I'm asking every school in Ohio to look at the school-based clinic model. It works. Take a look at it. Talk to your communities about partnering with your local hospital or your primary care clinics, community health centers, or children's hospitals. We want to help you get the technical expertise you need to build your own school-based health center, like how you can use our student wellness and success funds to build a clinic. That money that you have provided over the years can be used for a clinic. It can be used to provide that kind of care. And so today I'm asking several of our state agencies to work together with school district leaders to provide needed technical assistance on how to utilize existing resources to build more high-quality, sustainable, school-based clinics. I want to talk now about the health of our youngest Ohioans. We know that the two biggest causes of death for infants are being born too early and not sleeping in a safe environment. I want to thank the General Assembly for working with us on so many different initiatives over the past 5 years to help vulnerable moms. With a focus on reducing premature births and encouraging safe sleep, we've helped thousands of pregnant women and new moms get medical care and other resources to access healthy food, breastfeeding support, baby cribs, and guidance on stress management. Working together, we've greatly expanded our home visiting program, where trained professionals come directly to the home of moms and parents to answer the many questions all new parents have, to serve also as a support when they're exhausted and worried, and to help them understand the importance of healthy living. And we will be helping nearly 36,000 expectant mothers this year to have healthy babies through our partnership with over 100 OBGYN medical practices to offer comprehensive care. That means not just providing prenatal clinical care, but also directing women to needed resources, needed services, including funding for housing, food, and transportation. I'm also pleased today to announce that we will be launching a new pilot program in 11 Ohio counties that we're calling Family Connects. Family Connects. Every new mom will be eligible in these 11 counties to receive a visit from a nurse about 3 weeks after delivering her baby. These visiting nurses can guide families to clinical or community supports, recognize when a mom and a baby may need additional help as a result of exhaustion or trouble with breastfeeding, and remind or teach new moms about how a baby can sleep safely. Similar programs that we've looked at have shown a track record of reducing infant mortality. In places where these programs have been implemented, rates of child Protective Service investigations have decreased by 44%, and mothers have showed a 30% drop in postpartum depression and a 50% reduction in emergency room visits. In our next budget, we'll present to you next year, I'll be asking you for additional support to take that Family Connects program statewide. When I took office, we started to reimagine health care in Ohio, starting by transforming Medicaid managed care to be focused more on positive health outcomes and less on the business of health care. Historically, our system has paid for health care providers to provide care when you need that care. We don't generally reward doctors for actually keeping you healthy. Well, we're changing that in a very, very big way. So today I'm very pleased to announce the creation of a first-of-its-kind partnership between the Ohio Department of Medicaid, the Ohio Children's Hospitals, and Medicaid managed care plans to change how we deliver and coordinate care for our children. We're calling this historic undertaking the Outcomes Acceleration for Kids Learning Network, or OAK for short. We'll no longer focus on sick care, but rather on well care. To do this, we will prioritize better management of childhood asthma, annual well care visits for infants and adolescents, follow-up care for families after leaving the emergency room when their child has a mental health crisis, and access to the latest life-saving treatments for children living with sickle cell disease. Let's take asthma as an example. Asthma affects one in every 12 children in Ohio. When asthma is not managed well, kids miss school, they can't participate in sports, their parents miss work, and trips to the emergency room are all too frequent. To manage asthma well, it requires taking the time to understand the needs and the circumstances of the family, making sure they have access to care and to medications, ensuring the school nurse knows the child's asthma action plan. These holistic actions all together are what kids and families need to manage asthma effectively. Our new learning network will reward and incentivize our healthcare system in a new way to focus on asthma prevention. Further, we have the ability to change the game for those children with sickle cell disease. It's a condition that can cause organ damage and stroke, reduce the quality of life, shorten the lives of those who have it. More than 4,500 Ohio children have sickle cell disease, and roughly 95% of them are African American. The disease impacts their lives in deep and profound ways. Youth with sickle cell disease miss an average of 20 to 40 days of school each year. Our network will help patients with the effective management of this disease and will connect them to the resources and the newly approved life-altering treatments that are now available. By doing so, we believe that within 3 years, Ohio can lead the nation in the treatment of sickle cell disease and actually cure the disease for Ohio's sickest children. As I have in my last two State of the State speeches, we focused our attention on mental health because we all know we're in a crisis in this country. Our children today are more isolated, more anxious, more depressed, and more suicidal. There are a lot of factors impacting the behavioral health of our children. But likely number one on the list is the use of smartphones and access to social media. And I want to talk about that right now. In his new book, The Anxious Generation, author and social psychologist Jonathan Haidt examines, among other things, the impact that smartphones have had on this generation, the first generation to go through puberty with instant and constant access to the internet. Giving a generation of children smartphones, and these are the author's words, was, and I quote, the largest uncontrolled experiment humanity has ever performed on its own children. And that experiment has failed, and failed miserably. I want to take a moment to recognize my Lieutenant Governor, John Houston, his wife, Tina, who's up in the balcony. Tina and John have really started a crusade against smartphone use in schools and for parental notification for children to use social media. I'm grateful for what they're doing. Let's give them a round of applause again. Recently, I joined the Lieutenant Governor and Tina for a roundtable discussion with educators about schools and their cell phone policies. What is happening today is bad. And if you don't believe me, talk to a teacher. Talk to a principal. Talk to a superintendent. They will all tell you how distracting phones are in the classroom and how negatively they can impact a child's mental health. When you talk to teachers in schools that have actually removed phones during the lunch period, they will tell you the change is miraculous. Guess what? Without phones, the lunchroom is noisy again. Instead of having their heads down, burying their phones, kids are talking and interacting and laughing and enjoying themselves. A number of Ohio schools have made the decision to eliminate smartphone use during the school day. And I believe clearly that is the right decision. These phones are clearly detrimental to learning. They're detrimental to our children's mental health. And they truly do need to be removed from our classrooms in Ohio. I want to thank the members of the General Assembly who have taken on this issue. That includes Stephanie Kunze, Bill DeMora, Representative Steve Demetrio, as well as Tom Young. Senator Andy Brenner is currently working on an amendment requiring all Ohio schools to adopt a smartphone policy that will minimize phone usage by students in the classroom and make those policies available for parents and communities to know about. I fully support this measure, and I encourage the General Assembly to take up this legislation and to pass it quickly. Further, we need to go after the social media companies that are targeting our kids, addicting them, and then monetizing that addiction. What they are doing is shameful. Last year, as part of our budget, I signed the law requiring parental consent for children under 16 to use social media. Got to get the parents' permission first. However, as you know, Federal Judge Marbley has enjoined the law from going into effect. But let's not be deterred. While it would be best if the federal government set a national standard, they've not acted, and we cannot and should not wait. Let's take the lessons we are learning from court rulings across the country, and let's develop a plan for Ohio that can be a blueprint for putting parents, not social media companies, back in charge of the digital lives of their children. I truly believe that we can craft a new law that is informed by the concerns expressed by Judge Marbley, is constitutional, and will accomplish all the things we want to do in the law that you previously passed. We can do this. And so I'm asking you to start working with us to get this done. We simply have no time to waste. Some children in Ohio have extremely complex behavioral health care needs. But if this is not your own child, it's hard for us to really imagine what these parents are really going through. So I want to share part of a letter mother sent to me about her son. I'm an adopting mother with three kids, including my son, Tom. He has been physically and sexually abused starting at the age of 5. In recent years, Tom started acting out and became physically aggressive, hitting walls and smashing furniture, threatening to hurt us with knives. I was scared every day and feared for the safety of our other kids. On one occasion, we had to lock ourselves and the other kids in the basement while we called the police to restrain our son. As a result of what he's been through, he ran away, started using drugs to cope, and was physically aggressive towards a convenience store owner. He was arrested and locked up in detention, and all he really needed was treatment. End of quote. These are not isolated cases. This is the reality of life for a lot of Ohio parents, and too often they just don't know where to turn. And really, they've been pretty much ignored. We're now giving them a lifeline through our Ohio Rise program. Created 2 years ago, the program connects families and children who have the most complicated needs to appropriate care and do all this in Ohio. All these children need more than a doctor. They need therapists, they need prescribers, they need teachers, school counselors, other caring people to help them. Families who participate in Ohio Rise are assigned a hands-on care coordinator to bring these professionals and supportive people together to plan and manage care with the goal of keeping children in their homes and their families together. Since I delivered my State of the State address last year, we have added 14,000 more Ohio children to Ohio Rise. Today we're serving 32,000 children and their families, 11,000 of whom are getting very intensive care, including Tom. His mother went on to say in the letter, "With nowhere else to turn, relinquishing custody of Tom seemed like my only option until I was connected to the Ohio Rise program. Since being enrolled in Ohio Rise, we now have a team of professionals to support Tom and our family. We found a residential treatment facility where he can live and receive the intensive treatment that he desperately needs. His behavior is improving, and we're able to visit him often. Additionally, Ohio Rise helped connect my entire family with therapy following the incidents, and we are healing." This is what complete wraparound care should look like, because no child, no parent, no family should ever walk alone. You know, one of the biggest complaints I hear as I travel around Ohio is from families who don't know where to turn for help when their child is in a mental health crisis. They don't know where to go. And so we're increasing the availability of immediate behavioral health care in the right place at the right time through the expansion of what we call mobile response stabilization services. These services are similar to what first responders do when they show up for a physical health emergency in the community. Our mobile crisis response units will deploy within 60 minutes directly to the youth experience distress. A team of trained professionals will conduct safety assessments, de-escalate situations, and offer peer support, among other services. When I took office, 13 Ohio counties had mobile response stabilization services. Today, with your help, we are now in 38 Ohio counties. And I intend to take this model to all 88 Ohio counties. So no matter where you live, if your child is in mental health crisis, that child will be able to get immediate care. When we talk about expanding mental health treatment, we all know that one of our state's greatest challenges is having enough professionals in the mental health field. the demand for behavioral health services had increased twice as fast as the increase in the workforce. So it's critical that more people go into the community-based behavioral health care to serve our most vulnerable Ohioans. We must dramatically increase the pool of people. And all of us, career, tech centers, our colleges, our universities, all of us must work aggressively as the demand for these jobs is astounding. By the end of this decade, Ohio will need 4,500 new chemical dependency professionals, 4,700 new counselors, 4,300 new social workers, and hundreds of new psychiatrists. With generous support from you, we've created the Great Minds Fellowship with the goal of attracting 4,000 new behavioral health professionals into the field. If you're pursuing a degree in certain areas of behavioral health, you can get $10,000 towards your education before you graduate. It's not a loan, it's a grant that you do not have to pay back. And Ohio's colleges and universities have the funds available right now. They have those funds available right now to spend on these students. So therefore, I'm calling on Ohio's college presidents, both four-year and two-year, to make this year count. Find these students, recruit them. The money's there. So get it into their hands and get them started in school. It will make a huge difference. I want to turn to foster care. Throughout my career, I've focused on the needs of children who at no fault of their own are placed in foster care. And we've made historic investments with your help to help these kids. And as a result, 1,000 fewer Ohio children are in foster care today than when I took office. Now, while that's certainly progress, we must and we can do better. Currently, there are more than 1,800 foster children who live in group settings. They live in group settings because they're not foster families willing or comfortable to take on the significant behavioral health challenges and the complex needs these foster children present. And though some of them do need to be in congregate care, the best place for most of them is ultimately in a foster home with adults who love them. There is great work going on right now in Northwest Ohio, where Sandusky, Seneca, Ottawa, and Wyandotte counties have partnered together to recruit foster parents to specifically help children with the most complex needs. Not only have they saved money, but they've also created the opportunity for children to remain in a home with a family. Representatives from these communities, these counties, are with us today in the gallery, and I want them to stand, and I want you to give them applause, if you would, for the work they're doing. Thank you. Right up there. We are now replicating what they're doing through a new pilot program that will help more counties to recruit and support local treatment foster homes by providing one-on-one support for families, 24/7 on-call casework and crisis counseling, and specialized training so that children with complex behavioral needs can stay in a home with a loving family that can remain actively involved in that child's treatment process. That's the goal. We're expanding that, and we're going to continue to expand it. I'm also very excited to announce, on Fran's behalf, a new effort to get all eligible children who are in foster care signed up to receive a monthly book from the Dolly Parton Imagination Library. And we're doing this by our Department of Children and Youth becoming a new affiliate organization. They develop a system to keep mailing addresses updated so that when a child moves around, as tragically they sometimes do, the monthly book delivery will always follow them. And so starting this summer, 5,000 children in Ohio's foster care system will begin receiving a monthly age-appropriate book from the Dolly Parton Imagination Library of Ohio. My friends, we've accomplished big things together. So it's really no wonder that Pennsylvania, as Governor Shapiro put it, and I quote the governor, is sick and tired of losing to friggin' Ohio. Think about it. Ohio's unemployment is at historic lows. The job market's booming. And unlike the federal government, Ohio now has the highest possible credit rating possible. We are a national leader in aerospace. We are making great progress protecting our precious Lake Erie and our other Ohio waterways through H2 Ohio. We have an outstanding state fair that we're making even better thanks to your investments. It's just a few short weeks, we'll be opening Ohio's 76th state park, Great Council State Park in Greene County, and yes, they all remain free. And Ohio's Hopewell Ceremonial Earthworks are now officially a UNESCO World Heritage Site. I am so grateful for all we've been able to accomplish together. But we have even more to do, additional urgent issues that we must address. Let me talk for a moment about them. First, let's talk about intoxicating hemp known as Delta 8. Widely unregulated, is readily found easily accessible to kids in gas stations and convenience stores in Ohio. It's disguised as candies, gummies, even breakfast cereal. It can cause hallucinations, vomiting, tremors, anxiety, dizziness, confusion, and even loss of consciousness. Just in the cases that were reported to the Ohio Poison Control Center, there were 100 Delta 8 poisonings last year. And of those, 40 were involving children aged 5 or younger. That's just what was reported. Further, a recent national survey of 12th graders found that over 11% had used Delta 8 in the past year. Because of a loophole in the law, Delta 8 can be sold as hemp without the warning labels and age restrictions associated with marijuana. And we know the companies that produce and sell these products intentionally market these harmful products to our children. Members of the General Assembly, today I'm asking you to pass legislation to ban the sale of these dangerous products to our children. Then there's marijuana. We must respect the will of Ohio voters. Absolutely. Absolutely. However, I doubt if very many people who voted yes on issue 2 wanted their kids breathing in marijuana smoke while walking in a public park or on a sidewalk to ball practice or smelling the stench of it walking from the parking lot to a Guardians game or a Reds game. That's not what people voted for. But make no mistake about it, that is what the current law allows and will continue to allow until we do something about it. We owe it to our families to change that. And you have the power to do that. I ask you to exercise that power. It's not what people wanted. Now, let's not forget about the tobacco companies. They continue to target our kids, eager to addict the next generation through cigarettes, vaping, and flavored products. Here's a statistic. Nearly 81% of youths age 12 to 17 who have used a tobacco product report that the first product they ever tried was flavored. The Biden administration has the authority to stop the sale of flavored tobacco products, including menthol cigarettes and flavored vaping products, but they have not done so. I urge them to do that. But I think we've all learned that we can't depend on Washington. We have an obligation to protect Ohio children, and we have the ability to do that. Now, I understand the desire for uniformity statewide. I understand that. I get it. And so I'm asking you to pass a uniform state law banning flavored vaping and flavored cigarettes. It will save lives. We need to protect our kids. In November, I created the Ohio Juvenile Justice Working Group and asked them to conduct a holistic review of the juvenile justice system in Ohio. I was intentional involving juvenile judges in this review because of their knowledge and because it really is one system and because of their commitment to building programs that serve youth in their communities so they can remain with their families. These judges do a good job. The working group will review the whole juvenile justice system and will develop recommendations on behavioral health, safety and operations, staffing, and the youth population served. These recommendations, we already know, will include placing, one of the recommendations will be placing offenders in smaller state facilities. And so I will be asking you in the future for the resources to implement that very specific recommendation. We can't talk about the health of children without talking about gun violence. We have dedicated hundreds of millions of dollars, again, with your help, to help Ohio cities and local law enforcement protect Ohio children and citizens through investments in, among other things, new state-of-the-art crime prevention technology and higher staffing levels for the local police department. We have also sent in our Ohio State Highway Patrol, our Adult Pro Authority, and our Ohio Investigative Unit to work side by side with local police officers to surge into high crime areas to prevent violence and get guns out of the hands of those who are illegally armed. In Cleveland, for example, in Cleveland alone, last year, we supported authorities in arresting more than 100 suspects and seizing more than 450 illegally possessed firearms. And so, to Ohio's mayors, to Ohio's chiefs of police, to Ohio's local safety directors, our team is ready and willing to surge in and help. Just call us. We'll be there. We also have an obligation to keep our children safe on Ohio roads and highways. Thank you. Thank you for passing the distracted driving law. Because of your action, the lives of many children and adults are being saved. In fact, a study just released last week estimates that the Ohio distracted driving law has already prevented 3,600 crashes, 2,000 injuries, and saved 17 lives. We also know that a primary seatbelt law would protect people traveling on Ohio's highways. Here are the statistics, and they're not good. Ohio is 10th from the bottom, 10th from the bottom of all states in seatbelt use. While the national average for seatbelt use is 91%, Ohio's number is only 81%. 91, 81. And sadly, our youngest drivers have the lowest rate of all. That's why I'll be coming to you with a proposal to save young people's lives and adults through a primary seatbelt law. We know it works. It's a vote that will save lives. And we'll be bringing that to you. Before we conclude, I want to take a moment to remember the five respected former leaders from this body who have died since the start of this year. Former Senate President Stan Aronoff, former Speaker of the House Chuck Curtis, former Senate Majority Leader Ted Gray, former Senate Minority Leader C.J. Prentice, and former House Minority Whip Bridget Kelly. Each of them embodied what is truly great about Ohio. By always looking to the rising sun, focusing on what is important to Ohio families, and fighting for the betterment of the whole state. They will be missed, but they will always be remembered. In January, Fran and I had the great privilege to host at the governor's residence and honor some of the most heroic figures who have defined our nation's aerospace history. They came to Ohio for the unveiling of Ohioans in Space, Bill Hinch's grand painting of Ohio's space legends, John Glenn, Neil Armstrong, Jim Lovell, Judith Resnick, and Gene Kranz. These American heroes now take their rightful place in our beautiful and historic State House Rotunda, across from the Wright brothers. It was truly a thrill to meet and listen to Toledo native Gene Kranz, who directed America's missions to the moon through the Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo programs. Mr. Kranz spoke of our early space pioneers, who willingly accepted great personal risk in the name of national progress, and how they eagerly accepted President Kennedy's challenge to place America's flag on the moon. They pushed the envelope, doing things that had never been done before. They were children of the Depression. Many were first-generation college graduates who grew up on farms in the Midwest. They were leaders. They were team builders. They stood for something greater than themselves. They loved their country and vowed to serve, always grounded in the strong work ethic and deeply held values they learned from their own parents. And they all had big dreams. Tomorrow will be the 54th anniversary of the liftoff of Apollo 13. Ohio's Gene Kranz was the mission flight director, and Ohio's Jim Lovell was the mission's commander. As we know, on the third day of the mission, an oxygen tank exploded, damaging the spacecraft, forcing the three-person crew into a lunar module designed to support only two people for 2 days. And that became their lifeboat for nearly 4 days. But this was their time in history. Failure, as we know it, was never going to be an option for them. This ingenious, courageous, resourceful team of risk-takers managed to return the spacecraft safely to Earth, splashing down 6 days after the mission began. When asked during the harrowing mission if he believed that this was going to be NASA's darkest moment, Director Kranz said, "No, this is going to be our finest hour. For all of us in Ohio, this is now our time in history. And we must act with great urgency to not squander this precious, finite window of opportunity when our children are growing up. This is our time to meet the challenges that I've laid out today, to do the hard things that matter and will make a lasting difference for our children and the future of Ohio. This is our time to chart Ohio's path forward as we protect our most precious resource, our children. We must protect our children so our newborn babies can grow and thrive, so our kids can be healthier and more resilient, so they learn to read, go to school, find a career that they're passionate about, and ultimately grow into thriving, productive, hardworking Ohio adults. This is our time to band together, to work together, to be resourceful, to be innovative, to be optimistic, to inspire, and yes, to lead. And when we do this, this will be Ohio's finest hour. Thank you. May God bless Ohio. Thank you very much.